So we've covered Mendel's basic laws of heredity, and we've correlated the behavior of Mendelian alleles with the behavior of chromosomes in their segregation to haploid gametic cells, the male cells, sperm, or pollen in plants, and the female reproductive cells, eggs. But now it's time to consider some apparent but not real exceptions to Mendelian inheritance. And Mendel, you will recall, was dealing with discrete phenotypes. So when he looked at tall versus short plants, or purple flowers versus white flowers, or green peas versus yellow peas, he was looking at very discrete phenotypes. But often in nature, when we go out and look at the genetic variation that exists, it doesn't separate into discrete alleles, or discrete phenotypes, I should say. For example, let's take human height. Here's an assemblage of humans aligned according to various categories of height. And here they are plotted out in a histogram. So we have height plotted versus the number of individuals, and we get a somewhat normal curve. And if you were to increase the sample size substantially, you would get a nice, smooth, normal curve with a mean at a little above 5 feet 6 inches, with a distribution of two tails around that mean. So this is a case where height clearly can't be divided, human height can't be divided into tall or short and simple alleles that govern that. And in the case of height, what we're dealing with are many genes, polygenic inheritance, in other words, each of which is, allele of which can contribute in a quantitative way to the phenotype that we are observing. So this is often called inheritance of quantitative traits. And it is Mendelian. It just appears to not be Mendelian because there's continuous variation. So we might identify continuous variation as a possible, as an apparent but not real exception to Mendelian inheritance. So here we have the fact that many genes can contribute to a particular phenotype. And to illustrate this, let's consider a simple model. So let's look at a model where we have three genes, let's imagine. Let's imagine we have three genes with alleles big A, little a, big B, little b, big C, little c. And in this model of polygenic inheritance of quantitative alleles, we will say that each large allele, A, B, or C, contributes, let's say, 3 inches to a default or base height. So let's make that base default height in our model here. This is just a model that we're doing. Let's make that 5 feet 0 inches. So if you have an individual which is homozygous little a, homozygous little b, and homozygous little c, their height is 5 feet 0 inches. Whereas if you have an individual that is heterozygous for the A gene, homozygous small allele for the B gene, and homozygous small allele for the C gene, that would be yield 5 feet 3 inches. That is, we have one large allele, and that large allele contributes 3 inches to a default height. If we had a triple heterozygote in our model, we would have 5 feet 9 inches, because we have 1, 2, 3 large alleles. So here the small alleles aren't necessarily recessive, they're just, they lead to a default state. They don't contribute, in other words, the small alleles don't contribute to an additional height above a default height. Well, let's look what would happen if this is our model here, where we have each large allele contributes 3 inches to 3 inches to a height that is above 5 feet 0 inches. Let's just consider what would happen if we had a triple heterozygote that mated with another triple heterozygote. And let's look at what would happen. We have to ask ourselves, how many genotypes of gametes could be produced by each of these? Well, we could draw them all out. We could make a Punnett square if we wanted to. It would be rather tedious, because If we have two alleles at each of three different genes, so we have two alleles at each of three different genes, that means that there are 2^3 possible combinations, or 8 possible combinations. And just for illustration, let's say big A, big B, big C could be one type. Big A, big B, little c could be another one. Big A, little b, little c could be another one. Big A, little b, big C could be another one. And likewise, we could do the same thing for looking at little a. We could have little a with big B and big C. We could have little a with big B and little c. We could have little a with little b and little c. And finally, we could have little a with little b and big C. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 possible genotypes. And likewise, we would have those for the other gametic genotypes coming from the other parent. And then if we were to look at the possible 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we would have a Punnett square that would have 64 possible genotypes in it. And you can immediately see that there would be a lot of variation in the genotypes of the offspring from this particular mating, or a lot of different possibilities in terms of the combinations of these alleles. And excuse me, and you would get everything varying from the triple homozygote of small alleles from 5 feet 0 inches all the way up to a triple homozygote for the large alleles, and that would equal a 6 foot 6 inch height. That is 18 inches above the base height of 5 feet 0 inches. And this is just a model to show that what you would get here is you would get a few very, very tall individuals, a few very, very short individuals, or shorter individuals, and basically everything in between, or close to everything in between, based on the combination of alleles that you could get in terms of the numbers of the large alleles that would be inherited here. Let's take just this square, for example. What would that be? If this is the 1, 2, 3rd one down, that would be this one here. It would be big A, little b, big C by little a, big b, big C. So the genotype of that offspring in this square here, in this square right here, would be big A, little a, big B, little b, that'd be big B and little b, and big C, big C. So that particular genotype, which is one of the 64, would have a phenotype of what? There'd be 1, 2, 3, 4 large alleles, which would yield 3 inches, it would be 12 inches above the base height. So this would be 6 feet 0 inches, that possible genotype there. So what you can see here is that continuous variation can be generated by polygenic inheritance of quantitative alleles. So we can refer to these as quantitative traits. And we have more than two genes. We have multiple genes. And of course, there could be many more than just three genes in our, as illustrated in our simple model. And you can begin to see then that continuous variation is not at all a contradiction of Mendelian inheritance. It simply points out that there can be many genes for that, all of which influence a particular phenotype. And I should say here, just parenthetically aside, that the reciprocal of this is where one gene, a single genotype, can influence a variety of phenotypes. And you see this often in disease syndromes, where the mutation of a single gene leads to a variety of phenotypes that are usually have some type of pathology associated with them. And that That phenomenon is called pleiotropy. But that I say that only parenthetically aside. The main point here is that when you have multiple genes all contributing to a single phenotype, that can produce continuous variation. Another source of continuous variation, which again is not at all a contradiction of Mendelian inheritance, involves multiple alleles. So before we were looking at many genes with just a few alleles affecting a single phenotype. Here we're looking at a single gene with multiple alleles, all of which affect a particular phenotype. In this case, we're looking at coat color in rabbits. So we have different alleles here. We have big C, we have little c, we have little c H, little c CH for chinchilla, H stands for Himalayan, CH stands for chinchilla. And these four different alleles can be combined in a variety of ways into a variety of genotypes. So if you are homozygous for big C or heterozygous for big C, little c chinchilla, or if you are big C heterozygous for little c Himalayan, or just big C over little c, then you are a dark gray rabbit. So here we have a dominant C allele that encodes dark gray. And if you are homozygous for the small chinchilla allele, then you have a chinchilla phenotype. Nice soft fur, looks like a chinchilla. If you are heterozygous for chinchilla and Himalayan, or for chinchilla and the small C allele, then you have a light gray phenotype that's somewhat different than a straight chinchilla. If you are homozygous for the Himalayan allele or heterozygous for Himalayan and little c, then you will have a Himalayan phenotype. Whereas you are albino if you are homozygous for the little c allele. So here with only four alleles, we see that we can produce a variety of phenotypes. Again, multiple alleles with looking at one gene. So another source of continuous variation or pseudo-continuous variation is single genes with multiple alleles. And in the population, there can be hundreds of alleles existing in nature in a population. Only two alleles, of course, appear in any given individual. But the fact that there can be many alleles in the population means that in terms of the variation that you find in nature, it can be huge just because one gene can have many different alleles. Now, what I'd like to move on to in the next part of this lecture is to look at other apparent but not real exceptions to Mendelian inheritance. And we're going to look at gene interaction, which involve alleles of the same gene that interact. And then we'll look at gene interaction where alleles of different genes interact in a phenomenon that we call epistasis. So that's where we're going in the next part of this lecture.